Thank you. First of all, thank you, David, for and the B&H Event Space for having us present here today. It's a real dream and pleasure to be here. So it's really lovely to see so many friendly faces here. Thank you all for coming. What we will do today is we're going to present basically our project that we're working on, Photographer Square, the Great American Shootout. We'll start with doing biographies and histories of ourselves, just so you have an understanding of our philosophy, our technique. We will also show images that we've taken, just so you have an idea of what our style is. Then we will talk about the project and the details of the project, and then we will have time for Q&A, so if you have any questions, you can ask then. So I will start with my biography. This is me, 2 years old. As you can see, I have European parents. I don't think any American parents would have dressed their daughter up in this type of outfit. But I am a native New Yorker. I grew up here in the city. And I went to the Rudolf Steiner School, which some of you may know. It's a Waldorf school, so their philosophy is really about creative nurturing. So from the age of 3 all the way up to 18, I had a lot of creative spirit instilled within me, so that was pretty exciting. As a teen, as a child, I loved to draw, I loved to paint, and I loved to write. So I was very much in the creative world. I went to NYU. I was an English literature major specializing in fiction writing. So I was on that creative path. And then my first job out of college was in a bank doing IT. So I was a techie geek for over 10 years. So here's a story of a techie geek gone wild. So I was heavily into IT. Running and doing the email infrastructure there, and it was not my dream job, but I actually look back and I'm very grateful that I had that experience because I did learn a lot. The one good thing about the job was that they transferred me over to Luxembourg, so I moved to Europe. And when I lived there, my two biggest passions is travel and photography. So I was traveling every weekend. I was going to France and Germany and Brussels and Italy and all with my film camera then. We didn't have digital. And I would be in all these amazing locations and I would take my shots, and they were kind of boring and not very exciting. So I actually spent a lot of time painting while I was living in Luxembourg. I always needed some sort of creative outlet just to balance my life a little bit. I then realized that IT just wasn't it. I wasn't a computer geek. I wasn't meant to be that for the rest of my life. So I quit my job and I moved to Switzerland. I did my master's there. I did my MBA in media and communications. So my thought was to go more into a creative environment within the corporate world. So I lived in Switzerland, and I still kind of kick myself sometimes wishing that I knew what I know now with my photography, because the landscape in Switzerland is just amazing. So I lived in Switzerland for a couple of years, and then I moved back to New York. And when I moved back here, I realized that there's no city like New York City. New York City rocks. It's, you know, every neighborhood, different energy, different smells, different colors. And I said, you know what? I'm going to immerse myself in photography. I'm going to take classes. I speak the language here. I understand the language. I'm going to do it. So I started taking classes, and almost on day one, I was extremely frustrated. The class was super, super technical. Now for me, because I had such a technical background in IT, I wanted my photography to be fun and spontaneous and joyful. I wanted to enjoy the process instead of thinking with every photo I took. I didn't want to have to think of ISO and shutter and aperture and all that. So some other reasons why I was frustrated besides the technical component was I realized that they were teaching us to be robots. We were all kind of doing the same shots in the same way, photographing the same subject. And the teacher and the school, and schools in general, I think, teach you to be ordinary when we all have the potential of being extraordinary. So a lot of the teachers and schools don't push us further to find our creative eye and to help us find what our true voice is. The other thing that frustrated me was if the teacher would take us out in a group, they would say, all right, everybody, photograph that lamppost. Well, what if I wasn't connecting to that lamppost? Why should I photograph something that just didn't resonate with me? It made absolutely no sense. So if there was a piece of gum on the floor with dust and feathers and you know, just this kind of thing there, but if that inspired me, that's the shot I wanted to take. I connected to it, right? So I started kind of thinking and analyzing, what is it that makes me different from everybody else in this classroom here? So what I did, I started skipping classes. I just couldn't sit in the classroom. And I was going out with my camera around my neck and exploring the city. And what I started recognizing was that for me personally, I prefer to take photos of moments. I want to capture the rawness of what's going on in front of me. If I'm walking around with a camera and multiple lenses, a tripod, a flash, a reflector, and all this equipment, when I see something unfolding, I'm going to be thinking, do I need another lens? Do I need a tripod? I'm going to miss the moment. And that to me is something that I don't want to do. So I want to be part of that moment. I want to experience that moment. I want to throw myself into it to capture it. So I was experimenting with this. Now at the same time, I was asking myself bigger life questions at that time. What's my purpose in my life? Who do I want to be when I grow up? What kind of person do I want to be? And I was asking the same type of questions with my photography. What kind of photographer do I want to be? What kind of photos do I want to capture? And it really became apparent to me that if I started really following my heart and my intuition and my gut, I was getting some pretty nice shots that I would have normally never seen or been exposed to. So I went back to my teacher and I asked him, do you photograph with your heart or your head? And he looked at me as if I was crazy. And he said, well, of course with your head, it has to be a technically perfect image. What is perfection, number one, right? What on this planet is perfect? Nature? Not really, right? The things that make us beautiful as human beings are our imperfections. And I like to think the same with our art form. I could spend hours trying to make an image technically perfect, but that's not the type of person nor photographer that I want to be. I want to feel alive. I want to be in the moment. I want to be able to experience photography. So hence, I was a frustrated photographer. I wasn't feeling like I was connecting to anyone or anything. Now, at that time in my life, I was working here in New York City. I was actually a freelancer, and I had my then dream job. I was working in the communications department, exactly what it was that I studied. I was writing newsletter articles. I was taking photos for the newsletter. I was editing content. And I just was not happy. So in 2009, I decided to quit my job, leave the corporate world altogether, and launch my photography business. Everybody thought I was absolutely insane. How could I give up a well-paying job to become an artist, especially in the middle of the financial crisis? And I said, you know what? I don't want to be 90 years old and look back on my life and say, I regret, I should have, why didn't I? I don't want to be that type of person. If I fail, if nobody wants to buy my art, if I just don't capture beautiful subjects, I can always go back to the corporate world. I have the experience and I have the knowledge that I could do that, but I just knew with every cell in my body, I had to try this. So I launched my business, and then a year later, I actually created my class, The Art of Intuitive Photography. So I had been searching for teachers to help me here in New York to really kind of open my eyes with creativity in photography, and I found some. But there weren't too many, so I kind of had that aha moment where I said, well, if I'm photographing this way, others might want to as well, so maybe I should just try to teach and see if anybody resonates with it. So I launched it, and here we are a couple years later, still going strong, doing workshops in Switzerland, and I'm doing a workshop in Spain in February, which is super exciting. So for me, it's really it's really kind of letting go of control and surrendering yourself to your environment when you photograph. I often tell my students, you know, you could go to Carnegie Hall tonight and listen to a piano concerto. It can be performed technically perfect, and it could be absolutely lovely, and you may fall asleep, right? But if they perform with heart and soul, then there's a visceral experience. You feel something, hopefully. Either goosebumps, you tear up. That's what I want my photography to be as well. So if somebody looks at my imagery, they say, wow, okay, yeah, I can feel something here. I can see it, I can feel it. It could be, I mean, for me, a photograph should either tell a story or be a poem. There should be something deeper. And the only way that I really feel that can happen is if you photograph from here and not from here. A short little story. I was asked a couple of years ago if I wanted to spend New Year's Eve in a house by myself, cat sitting a sick cat. And the house is on the beach, and for me it's a dream to have a house to myself on the beach. New Year's Eve, perfect, I don't have to deal with anyone or anything. So I took them up on their offer, and one of my New Year's resolutions that year was to slow down in life and in photography. What I had noticed is that when I go away on vacations, if I'm doing trips, when I'm photographing, I actually experience it all through my camera and not for myself. And I said, wait a second, I want to enjoy this too. I just don't want to look at the pictures and say, oh, right, okay. So I wanted to really slow down. So January 1st that year, I got up to photograph the sunrise. And I was the only person out there. It was me and the seagulls. It was absolutely beautiful. And I just wanted to really appreciate that moment. So I was standing on the beach in kind of a complete gratitude for the beauty, and also making an intention for the year of what I wanted the year to bring me. So once I did that and I really connected with this beauty, I started taking photographs. So I created a series that's on my website. It's called CCSEASEE. And so every time I go back to that house, I take photos and show it in different seasons and different times of day. One of my private clients, she has bought, I believe, 3 or 4 prints from that series. And without really knowing my philosophy, she approached me and she said, Mindy, every time I look at your images, I can feel peace. I could smell the salt air. So I know, and I keep getting comments like that, I know there's something deeper when you approach photography from here. So so I've become an enlightened photographer after my frustrating years of trying to make it happen. So I'll talk a little bit about my imagery. This is one of my signature images. I took this a couple years ago. As you can see, we had a blizzard. And you know, intuition can manifest in different ways. For me, again, what I tell a lot of my students is surrendering, let go of control. It's about being vulnerable. And what that means is just kind of being in that moment without controlling what type of image you want to capture, what the subject should be, or, you know, today I have to capture the most amazing image ever. It's not about that. It's really just enjoying the process and trying to tap into that little boy or that little girl that's within you, and approach your environment with curiosity and wonder. We tend to lose that as adults. We don't have fun anymore, really. So that morning I woke up and I had 3 words pop into my mind: Central Park, dogs, and snow. And I was like, okay, cool. You know, I put on my snow pants, I got myself all geared up. Had no idea what was gonna happen, but I made it fun. And so I go into the great lawn, and there are these dogs running around chasing each other. Now, I don't know these dogs, I don't know the owners, but I just plopped myself right in the snow. I sat right there, and as they were running in a circle, they just happened to turn around and run straight at me. So I have my camera set, and I took the shot. So shooting intuitively doesn't mean not thinking at all, I only photograph in manual mode. It's the only way I can photograph. So it's really important to have an understanding of how the camera works that you can develop your eye and your skills later on. But my intuition here, it was just a simple Central Park dog snow. Let's go, let's have some fun, let's see what happens. This image is, I was meeting a friend for dinner and it was nighttime and winter. And I had the camera around my neck and I'm walking down the street and my voice pops up and says, turn left at the corner. Now, I have, my intuition communicates with me as a voice, but then my conditioned voice popped in. Now, we all have the conditioned voice. It's the voice of our parents, of our teachers, of society, of what we should do, right? That voice popped up and said, don't turn left. This is ridiculous. You're going to be late. Your friend's going to be upset. Just go meet him. I've learned not to listen to that voice because I know it's not my real voice. So I turned left at the corner. There was steam coming up out of a subway grate. Cars were coming towards me, so the headlight of the cars was illuminating the steam. There's a man walking down the street, and that's a shadow superimposed on the steam from the headlights. So this is what I saw. This is not some sort of crazy Photoshop thing. I am very much a minimalist in post-production. What I tell my students, I put makeup on my photo, I don't do plastic surgery. So I don't go crazy. I took the shot in color, I converted it to black and white. Boosted the contrast, the highlights, that was it. So magic happens when you shoot intuitively and you follow your feelings and how your body reacts to certain things. Magic happens and you're really experiencing photography. So, you know, this keeps happening time and time again where I've learned to trust it. And again, it's a matter of trusting yourself, trusting your voice and becoming vulnerable. What I sometimes say to my students is, it's kind of the same as if you would go into Central Park in the middle of the Great Lawn, take off all your clothes and stand there completely naked and say, love me or hate me. You know, it's the same thing. When you create an image, you're creating it for yourself, not for anyone else. If you show a photograph to 10 different people, you're going to get 10 plus different responses. So just be true to yourself and just follow through with that. So this is now some of my newer imagery. It's a little bit of maybe an optical illusion. I'm not sure if you can see it on the screen or not, but this was taken in a subway station, and it was raining. So there's some of the subway stations, we have these huge puddles of water, right, in the stairs. So I'm standing on the stairs, and there was this beautiful light streaming down, and a man just happened to walk up the stairs with his umbrella, and that's his shadow, or the reflection superimposed on the puddle of water. So I was right there, ready for that shot. So in April, I went to Ireland, and I've been wanting to go to Ireland, to the west coast of Ireland for a long, long time. And I had no intention of what I wanted to photograph. I wanted it to be spontaneous and really kind of connect with whatever was around me. So here we are, and I'm just drawn because I love painting, and I've turned into somehow very much a colorful photographer the past 2 years. I was drawn to more abstracts, and so I saw the patterns, the lines, the textures here, and it just completely intrigued me. And I said, bingo! This is what I need to photograph. So these are some examples of what I saw, and again, my desire, my interest, my passion for painting and textures as well, playing with the lights and the shadows and the colors. Here's another example. Keeping it very clean, keeping it very simple. This was actually taken in Dublin, and this is kind of like a fun shot. Again, I try to be like this little kid, and I saw this bench, and if you can see, there's this green kind of glass portion through the middle of the bench, and there was a reflection on the bench, and in that green section, it was kind of really illuminated and highlighted. It just kind of shone out to me super crisply, and I said, okay, that's the shot, because I also saw the blue of the bench with the moss on the bottom, so again, the play of colors all together. How could I not take photos of New York City? I mean, it's my hometown, right? So Not that long ago, actually, just maybe a month or so ago, I was going to a conference at the Javits Center. It's early morning, and I get out of the subway, and I'm walking west, and I kind of feel this tug on my shoulder, and there was no one there, and I just looked back, and I saw the light. There was all this mist and fog covering part of the Empire State Building, and just the play of light was phenomenal, so I just had to capture that, so. That was really a physical sensation, like my intuition saying, hey, check out what's behind you. And this is the romantic in me. I can't help it. I'm sorry. I was walking in the park, and this puddle was in the shape of a heart. So I just thought it was really sweet. So I decided to include that as my last slide of showing my intuitive work. All right. It's all yours.
Thank you, Mindy.
You're welcome.
Okay. Can you hear me? Can you hear me back there?
Yes.
Okay. Well, because every time I give one of these things, people always say, "Can't hear you. I can't hear you." Okay. All right. So, my name is RA Friedman. I'm the film photographer side of this particular project. We're going to talk a little bit about kind of how I got started in photography and kind of rediscovered photography. This is actually me, about 3 years old. I've always been very, very interested in cameras. I'm a native New Yorker, even though I have not lived in New York City since I was 11. I've been living in Philadelphia for the last 20 years. Most of my photography has been done in Philadelphia, covering the urban landscape. I have covered probably thousands of miles on foot, largely with a film camera, photographing Philly as it has changed, as it has morphed. I'm now finding myself much more in New York City, especially for the more sort of commercial / paid side of the photography that I do. I am sole proprietor and lead photographer for a vintage photo booth called Circus Photographica. Circus being Yiddish for circus, and Photographica actually Polish for photography. I have a Polish-Yiddish background, so I figured, hey, this would be a good name for the operation. Primarily what I do is I photograph at late night events, steampunk type events, if you're familiar with the steampunk genre, vintage type things, retro type things. You may have seen me at the Jazz Age lawn party photographing with some very, very funky cameras, combinations of analog fronts and digital backs. Let me just sort of regroup my brain for a moment here. Let me tell you a little bit about my background. So that's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing now. Let me tell you a little bit about how I got to where I am now, which is what I initially started to tell you. I started out doing photography back in the age when people shot on film. I shot all through junior high school and into high school. I developed my own film. I had a dark room. I spent most of my high school years, I think, souping film and making prints when photography was really considered much more special in some ways because there were fewer people going from capture to print on silver. I kind of took a break from photography as I got into college. I started out as a physics major, sort of segued into studying theater and fine arts, and eventually went for an MFA in painting. I realized as I was sitting here, Mindy was talking about the teachers that she had, is that I'm actually a self-taught photographer. The closest thing that I had to a formal education in photography was I worked for a commercial photographer in New York City for a fairly short time when I was a teenager, but that's about it. A few things that my dad showed me about depth of field and so forth. So what happened was I ended up getting into painting, and then around 2005, something very strange happened. A freezer failed. Okay, what's the connection here? My dad, who is an engineer and a bit of a hoarder and really kind of was very, very into photography, probably back in the 1950s, 1960s, and even into the 1970s, when Polaroid stopped making the old-style film, that consisted of a receiving roll and the actual negative film itself. He stocked up on the material when the local department store decided to unload it at $1 a roll. How could he resist? He bought 100 rolls because he had the camera and he wanted to use it. He wanted to make sure he had enough film to pretty much last forever. Well, we shot a lot of it when I was a kid, when I was in high school. He gave me some and I took it to college because that was the pre-digital age. I was doing some photography for the school newspaper. So whenever we needed a shot really fast, I would pull out the Polaroid and shoot it. But I used all of it up. I didn't think that there was any left. So I'm back at my parents in 2005, and the freezer fails. My dad had a huge side-by-side freezer out in his shop, and we're emptying it out. You know, we got chickens from 1980 and dead ice cream, and you know, it's definitely not a fun affair. And as we're emptying out all this stuff into the garbage, at the bottom of the freezer, 35 rolls of frozen Polaroid film with an expiration date of 1977. Just gotta keep an eye on the time here. So my dad says, here, take it. He gives me the film. He gave me his Polaroid 110A. I don't know if you're familiar with that camera. You'll actually see it in this next video. It was a very, very expensive Polaroid camera. Actually, I think it was the top of the line. So the real question was, what do we do with all this film? What do we do with this camera? I was then working at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania as their rights and reproduction coordinator. This is in Philadelphia. And I got together with a few colleagues and we decided we have to do a project that uses up all the film in one fell swoop. People get a lot of enjoyment out of, and we do something creative with it. So we came up with an idea. We said, okay, we'll shoot on the street. We'll shoot street portraits with the camera, basically formal portraits, and we'll have people dress up and we'll give them the prints. We won't charge them anything. We'll just say, here, take this and have fun with it. And that's exactly what we did. So let me roll the video. So this is Jessica running the camera. It's been sped up a little bit, so it's a little bit like one of those old-fashioned silent movies. So it's a little bit fast, but you can see her loading the camera with the receiving sheet at the top. And you really have to be kind of a little bit of a tech geek to really enjoy one of these cameras. I love them. And my father obviously liked it too, but you kind of have to have three hands to load the thing. And then you can see her pulling down. That is actually the negative part of the film. So what we did was we saved that part of the Polaroid. We saved these sort of what they're sometimes called goop negatives. And you'll see it when she opens up the back of the camera. She's actually shooting Peter Heiler, who's the owner of the Book Trader. He was nice enough to let us use his street space as we did these during the 2005 Philadelphia Fringe Festival. So we had all kinds of performers and people going to shows that would stop in. And you can see she peels the print out of the back of the camera. That's the goop negative up at the top. And a perfect Polaroid print. We ended up doing 170 of these. We didn't fix them. I don't know if you're familiar with the fixer that the Polaroid used, but it has an almost toxic waste smell. Once you smell that Polaroid coater, you'll never forget it. We did not do that. So we told people, if you want to keep the print, go ahead and scan it, or put it in a drawer and put the date on it, and your grandkids will find it, or something like that. So I got very, very interested in this whole process of scanning in these goop negatives and then basically reviving them in Photoshop, which is what we did. We posted them online. And what it really ended up giving birth to was a whole new way of doing photography, essentially like printmaking. And it was also the birth of Circus Photographica, because what started to happen was I started to get gigs bringing my antique Polaroid camera. I ended up buying a couple of old Graflexes that I used, selling the Polaroids basically on a per piece basis for people who posed, and then taking the negatives home and then working on them. Of course, it was very, very labor intensive. If I did a shoot of 60 people, I could be a month working on these so that I could get them all posted up online, usually on Facebook, is where that they where they went. But it did yield some very, very interesting results, and it was a great tuition in terms of jumping back into working with Photoshop. So kind of concurrently with that, this was around 2006 and 2007. There was a lot of Polaroid film still around. There was 4x5. I would call up the Polaroid distributor and cry on their shoulder, and they would send me short dated film. I was experimenting with all kinds of emulsions and pretty much anything I could get my hands on that was light sensitive. I bought a 4x5 Crown Graphic, which was kind of the archetypal press camera. If you've ever seen Superman, it's the one that Jimmy Olsen carries. I think it's also the one that Ouija used to carry. It's a very simple 4x5. It doesn't have a lot of swings and tilts, but it was great for working in the studio, and it was kind of a very different way of working, and I could get people to come and model for me once they had seen some of the work. So I did some fashion shoots. I did some various things, some conceptual pieces in the studio. But it kind of dead-ended. my background is in painting. I guess I could say I'm a failed painter. I never really got painting to do what I wanted. And one of the problems that I really found I had with painting is that working in the studio is very isolating. It's a very isolating kind of experience. You work very solitarily. You're really very much on your own to come up with ideas and sort of concepts and things that are not like what's come before them. And I started to feel the photography was starting to become a little too artificial for me, and I felt that the atmosphere was becoming a little too rarefied. So this didn't happen overnight, but I kind of solved the problem. I decided I'd shoot the landscape. Now, wasn't really that big of a jump because I was already doing a lot of photography anyway. I was already playing around with a lot of different kinds of instruments in terms of cameras. And this was a shot that I did actually with a $20 toy camera. I already had garnered a fair amount of experience with Photoshop in terms of just adjusting levels and areas of tone and contrast, much like Mindy. I don't believe in plastic surgery on my images. I pretty much work from a scanned negative and then really just do a conversion sometimes to black and white if it's a color negative, and then just start working locally in layers in Photoshop to darken areas, bring out contrast. There are times when I might actually go in and paint a mask by hand, but that's about the extent of it. So I started doing that, and initially, all I really had that I could handle was a very inexpensive digital camera. This was taken with a Canon SD600, I think. These are going on eBay now for about $30. It's basically just a point and shoot. The reason that I included it was I really wanted to kind of drive home the idea that the camera, I know it's very easy to say the camera doesn't matter. I won't say that. The camera is mainly is a tool, and the better the camera, the better the chance you may have of actually getting the shot that you envision. But at the same time, if you know the limitations of what you're working with, you can take great photographs. I hope you think this is decent with pretty much any kind of camera. And this was taken with basically a point and shoot at. Late on a day, very, very close to New Year's. It was very cold, and as I recall, I was waiting around for the foreground figure to appear, and luckily I didn't have to wait too long. And again, this was shot in color, and then a little bit of work in Photoshop doing the conversion. One thing I want to say is, even though I shoot almost primarily medium format film, I'm not a film chauvinist. This was actually taken with a bridge camera, a Lumix. Sometimes it's really, really nice to carry a nice light digital camera with a zoom lens, especially as you're moving around cities. This particular shot could not have happened with a film camera. at least not at my skill level. Maybe someone else might have been able to have pulled it off. It was actually shot off of the Manhattan Bridge with the lens of the very, very small micro four-thirds zoom poked through a chain link fence. And that's almost impossible to do with almost any other kind of camera. So it really came in handy. One of the things that I found about shooting off of bridges is they bounce. So this was a real sort of almost zen-like exercise in patience, waiting for the bridge to damp down after the N and the Q train kept on going across and making the camera go like this, and the Lumix does not have anti-shake, doesn't have any gyroscopic correction in the camera. So if you shake, it shakes. So that being said, as I started shooting more and more in the Philadelphia landscape around 2012, I actually started a weekly email. It was kind of a self-imposed project. I decided I would try to produce one, what I would consider noteworthy image per week, one image that I would feel proud enough to say, here, I'm going to email blast it out to 160 plus people that I know who follow my work, which was small. So when I started doing that, I immediately decided I wanted to shoot on film again. Something was tugging on me that said, shoot film again. And I think part of it was kind of the simplicity of film. I really wanted something that was really going to capture sort of the grittiness and texture of Philadelphia. It really has that kind of feel to it. And I think it was sort of the other part was, it was kind of the difference between flying from like New York to Philadelphia in a jet versus trying to navigate with a glider or a hang glider or maybe a small plane. It was kind of that kind of difference. It was sort of the idea, I want to kind of fly a little bit by the seat of my pants, as it were. So I was very happy to start shooting film again. This was shot on 35 millimeter with an old Nikon that I had, that I had actually used in high school. I was happy with the results. I was scanning the negatives on my own and making inkjet prints when I could. But I found very, very quickly that the 35 millimeter was not really doing what I wanted it to do. It wasn't capturing enough detail. I wanted more detail. I wanted more tonality. So I guess it was the painter in me. I wanted more push-pull in the image. I wanted more things in the foreground to pull forward. I wanted more things in the background to pull back. So I immediately made the jump. Well, actually not. That's sort of a misnomer. What really happened was, is I tried a lot of different cameras to that were medium format, eventually settling on the Hasselblad. The Hasselblad turned out to be the camera that had the kind of look that I wanted to create. I tried a few others, which I will show you. The Hasselblad really kind of created the kind of look that I wanted. It had the kind of layout that felt good to me. I liked the quality of the way the camera handled. And so far, it had seemed very, very reliable. So it sort of became the go-to camera for doing these. The other thing that I found out is that I'm kind of not a street photographer. I know everyone, you know, you see the work by Cartier-Bresson, and you're photographing in the street, and you kind of immediately assume, yeah, that's kind of what I want to do. I want to be like, you know, out, you know, shooting, you know, all the hurly-burly that's going on out in the street. And the thing that I found is even though I eventually established a kind of confidence level being out on the street, and Philly is, I love Philly, don't get me wrong, I totally love Philadelphia, but Philly is very different from New York. It's more of a small town feel, and it's more kind of an in-your-face kind of city. So if you're out photographing, you might have people come up to you and say, are you from the city? Like what's, you know, like the city of Philadelphia, are you like photographing that church that's coming down for like, you know, the L&I or something, you know, licenses and inspections? So I get interrupted a lot more in Philly. So I really had to develop a kind of street demeanor. And the thing that I really learned was, is that the best way to approach the photography is much like a workman or work person. is basically, I'm just here to do a job. I'm like, you know, the people who are bringing in the sheetrock and taking it out, or digging up the street, or fixing the plumbing, or whatever it is. I'm just here with my camera, and I'm doing my thing. And generally, that has worked quite well. I try not to trespass, but you'll see occasionally I run into a little bit of trouble. But sort of getting back to the Cartier-Bresson idea, I found out that I was really not Cartier-Bresson in a can, even though I would like to be. That I was much more of a kind of urban wanderer, and that I was really looking for sort of old remnants of Philadelphia, things that still had kind of the echoes of the city that I knew when I moved there in 1994, things that maybe even kind of went back even further, sort of little reverential corners of the city. This is an area down in Northern Liberties, which is sort of the lower northern quadrant of the city down by the Delaware River. And I've been back to this spot a number of times. That it continues to be there is really quite amazing. And I photographed it a number of times. And I was very lucky. I did not have the Hasselblad when I first discovered it, but it survived into my ownership of that particular camera, and I was able to capture it. The thing about the Hasselblad is you kind of either love it or hate it. So hopefully it's clear sort of where I fall with it. It has a very particular kind of vision. It has, usually when I shoot with it, I'm very much like Mindy. I shoot with one lens. I shoot with the 80 millimeter, which is just the standard lens that the camera comes with. It's a standard angle of view. This is South Street in Philadelphia. And it's just actually was a very ordinary place. It was just a place that sold sort of medical supplies, but kind of a vestige of old Philadelphia. Stores like this in Philly are rapidly disappearing. Everything is getting knocked down, and new construction is happening. So I was talking about not getting in trouble for trespassing. This was actually taken in a part of Philadelphia called the Eraserhood. I don't know if people are familiar with David Lynch and Eraserhead, a sort of archetypal underground movie that is now mainstream. He lived in this particular neighborhood, and there's this steam generator. The day that I took this, I actually was, in fact, technically trespassing. I was standing in a parking lot that was private property, and whoever was managing started to say that he was going to call his insurance company. Meanwhile, he had someone who was parking their car, who was actually doing the car parking for them, was trying to shake me down for money. So it was not a particularly great day of photographing until this shot happened. I was shooting with my aunt's old Hasselblad, an old 1000F. From the 1950s on a tripod, no less. And I had set the shot up. I believe I had seen the man in the shot coming down the street, and I just waited. And the timing worked out. One of the things that I wanted to say about the Hasselblads is I know they have a reputation for being kind of pricey, even on the used market. If you consider what a full-frame DSLR runs for these days versus a Hasselblad with a lens in good condition, it's about half. So the film cameras are kind of more pay-as-you-go. So it's the initial cost is not that high, but it's kind of the maintenance, the film, the developing, that you sort of pay for along the way. So the 1000Fs are still around. They're fairly inexpensive to buy, but most of them have become collector's items, and I would not recommend them. My tech, who repaired this, I have a really good camera repair guy in Vermont who I send cameras to, pretty much was tearing his hair out trying to get it to work. Most of the ones that are on collector's shelves are jammed, so they're notorious. So I would say probably stay away from them. But they are a fairly good image capture device when you get them to work. If you want to go super, super cheap, and I love to experiment with all these kind of odd cameras that come my way, you could shoot with an Argoflex from the 1950s, which was a real popular consumer camera. They take 620 film, so if you get one, you'll have to re-spool your 120 film. onto a 620 reel because the actual sort of winding slot is a little bit smaller and the reels are a little bit smaller. So this was taken with that on respooled film. One of the things that I wanted to mention about this particular shot and sort of the changing landscape is the building on the left-hand side. I don't know my right from my left. The left-hand side, even as we speak, is being taken down. So that that tableau is really kind of gone. And also the place where I stood, where I shot this, has now been fenced over. So I guess the thing being, jump on in while you can. One of the other things that I wanted to point out, and this is sort of a plug for film photography, is that film is sort of instant high value range photography. That is, it can capture a value range of maybe 10 or 12, sometimes 14 stops from the darkest to the lightest, and still get detail in images of and parts of the image. Most digital sensors, of course, they're getting better and better, so I better not speak too fast, but they're getting better and better. But the dynamic range is usually limited to around 8 to 10. So what I was actually able to do with this shot was, once I developed it, I did two scans, one for the really dark area of the print and one for the really light area of the print. And then I was able to combine them in Photoshop. So that I could get detail in the sky, which normally would be blown out. You just kind of have just whiteness, or you would have no detail in the dark area. So basically what I did was I exposed, I did the old film adage. I exposed for shadows and developed for highlights. But because it's roll film, I couldn't do the Ansel Adams thing of actually giving it less development, less time in the developer to cut back the highlights, which is what's usually done. So what I did was I compensated in the scanning. I know I've been bandying around names of cameras, so I just kind of wanted to give you a feel for kind of what they look like and sort of the quality levels and so forth. These are all, I have to admit, these are all cameras that I do work with. My house is kind of like a camera museum. I'm trying to cut back, but it's kind of a mania. This is the Hasselblad in the upper left-hand corner. Right below it is the Yashica. Kind of the it's kind of a Japanese clone from the 70s of the Rolleiflex, which is sort of considered kind of the Cadillac of twin lens cameras, a German. And there's the more humble Argoflex, which actually uses gears to slave together the two lenses. So you turn one and they both turn. It's kind of like, it's a lot like a Lubitel, which is the Lomo people sell. The Rolleiflex used to be a really good buy in terms of a used camera, and then someone came along and kind of wrecked it all, and she's not even living. Do you know who I'm talking about? Vivian Mayer. And in fact, this is the same, this is my Rolleiflex that I got for my 8th birthday. I won't tell you what year that was. I took very good care of it. It's been lovingly used. I continue to use it. It has a few issues that need to be worked out on it. They used to be a really good deal. You could pick them up on eBay for under $200, get an overhaul, and you'd have a great camera that you could do portraits with. They're great for doing landscape work. The lens is a little soft and creamy, but some people really like it, and I like it for certain subject matter. But with Vivian Mayer's documentary and work coming out, what has happened is a lot of people have said, wow, she took great photographs with this camera. I gotta have one for my collection. I gotta have one to shoot with. So the price on eBay has just gone through the roof. I have looked around recently and it looks like the prices are starting to come down again. People are realizing it's a good camera. I mean, but the thing is, it won't make you a great photographer. It's just a really great camera to work with. It has a really nice feel. Unlike the Yashica, it has a crank advance. And the one thing about the Rolleiflex that I really, really appreciate over the Yashica is the Yashica has the focusing lever, the focusing knob on the same side as the shutter release, which is a little weird. The Rolle has it on the left, which makes sense. It feels right. You're focusing with the left and advancing the film with the right. So it's a little bit funky, but it performs really, really well. Yashicas are going somewhere in the $100 to $200 range. B&H has used camera department, as do many of the large camera stores. So they're around, and of course there are the other traditional outlets who I will not plug. I just wanted to sort of give a quick heads up about developing film. If you shoot with film and you haven't given developing your own film a try, I would highly recommend it. I'm in Philadelphia a lot of times, so I'm not really near a lab that I particularly like. Most of the labs that I use, the lab that I really like is in New York, so I end up doing it myself. We'll leave it at that. The main thing that I just wanted to say about developing film is that the hardest part is getting the film in the tank. So once you learn how to get the film in the tank, you're golden. I mean, the rest is really just being careful, measuring out your film chemicals. I do everything in the kitchen sink. So I do keep a pretty close eye on the temperature. Maybe I'm a little bit more scrupulous than some people, but the black and white film is pretty forgiving. But the most important thing is when you open that tank and you see these negatives that you shot and you developed and you created and you pull that out, I don't know, it's like being 10 again and getting the birthday present that you always wanted. I know, it's just so exciting. And I have to say, I have never ruined a roll of film developing it myself, but I've had many, many labs do it. So kind of something to keep in mind. I included this shot. Actually, this was taken not with any of the cameras that I mentioned before. It was actually taken with a rather unusual folding camera from the 1950s. But the reason that I included this particular shot is that there are spots in Philadelphia, there are spots in New York now that I'm starting to come back to over and over again as they change. And I'm a really big believer in kind of having a beat. If there are areas or there are things that speak to you, revisit them. And this abandoned house on Ridge Avenue, actually right by the Divine Lorraine Hotel, which is getting some press lately, this sort of just borders on the eraser hood that I was talking about before. This was a day, very, very cold. I set out with a camera and a tripod, which I don't shoot with. I don't shoot with a tripod as much anymore. But for this, I did. And the light and the atmosphere and the clouds just kind of conspired to work for me. The other thing, too, is there were no cars parked on the street. Those are frequently an issue. The cars will be blocking it. And I cannot tell you how many times I've gone to shoot something, and immediately I get the camera to my eye, and I'm just about to shoot it, and a bus goes by. So this was a good day of photographing. Kind of dovetailing a little bit with what Mindy was talking about, sort of the intuitive moment with the film camera. I was shooting with a Rolleiflex down on Pine Street in Philadelphia, which is known as Antique Row. There are a lot of antique shops down there. And I had one shot left in the camera. It's like, I really want to just take that last shot and go home and develop the film or develop it the next day. And I saw this storefront that was being used as a studio and these eyes peeking out. And I just decided, okay, do something a little bit different. And there was something about it that just kind of appealed to me. And some interesting things I felt started to happen with the image. And this was taken with the old Rolleiflex, the 1950s era Rolleiflex. Okay, so in the words of Oscar Wilde, to tell all is boring. So I hope that I've only given you the most essential, the good stuff. This is a Rolleiflex shot. And with that, I will end my presentation and just say, onward. Thank you so much.
So we'll talk a little bit about the project that we're working on, the reason why you're here, Photographer Squared, the Great American Shootout. So as you can see, we're very different photographers, contrasting photographers. And for both of us, I believe that it's important that we want to share how everyone has a unique eye and a different approach to photography, and also influencing teens. So let's talk about this a little bit. I came up with this idea when I moved back to New York. I lived in Europe for 6 years, which was a long time. And as I had mentioned, I saw a lot of Europe. And when I moved back to New York, I realized I actually haven't seen much of America. I haven't seen much of my own homeland. So I was originally thinking, oh, I should just do kind of like a cross-country road trip and photograph and document the US. But as I started teaching and over the years, I started really recognizing that, again, if you're photographing intuitively, everyone really has a different eye. When I take my groups out and we do exercises and photograph, everyone captures something differently. And so I was intrigued by that idea, and I wanted to take this project kind of in that direction, where we could really showcase how everyone has a unique eye and a different approach to photography. So I was extremely happy when RA decided to join me on this venture, since we are such contrasting photographers, to create a body of work that can showcase this. Excuse me, I'm losing my voice. So. Originally, what we decided to do, we wanted a sense of adventure in this project. So, like I had mentioned, I'm all about spontaneity and adventure and all that. And so we decided that instead of saying, I want to go here, I want to go there, we bought a map and we closed our eyes and we randomly chose four locations. So we decided to do East Coast, West Coast, North, and South. So we were going to leave it up to fate to kind of take us to where we needed to go. And then the idea came that not only do we want to photograph, so basically we decided we will mutually agree to photograph the same subject. So it could be a gas station, it could be a person, it could be a broken down factory. We have no idea what it will be. But we will both agree on the subject. We will take minimal photographs. So RA will only use one roll of film, a 12-roll exposure. I will only limit myself to 12 exposures as well with my digital camera. One lens, one camera, no tripod, no flash, really, really simple, and take the shot. So we will be doing five subjects per location. Now, I had mentioned that we're doing four locations. We actually will be doing five locations. And you guys, that's why we gave out the little piece of paper. Presentation visitors and our backers and our social media followers will choose our fifth location. So again, kind of leaving that element of surprise out there. And we will. You guys can fill out the forms that you received, and there's a hat here, so you can just drop it in the hat, and you can be very specific as to where you want us to go for the fifth location. It could be, say, North Rim of the Grand Canyon, or it could be small little village or town somewhere, as long as it's in the United States, and then we will randomly pick the location. So we will be showcasing this as a hardcover 12 by 12 inch coffee table book. So basically my color photograph next to RA's black and white image to really, really showcase how we have a unique eye. Then the idea came up, well, what else can we do on this project? So we really both strongly feel that we want to help inspire teenagers. So we will be approaching local high schools in each location that we go to. And actually, RA has a really interesting story of how he was influenced when he was a teenager. You want to share that?
Yeah, I was really, you know, when we started talking about the idea of a teaching component of this, it really made me think about how when I was in high school and I was doing a lot of photography, and actually by that time I was no longer living in New York, I was actually in the Catskills, going to a very small high school. There were only 60 people in my graduating class in a place called Grahamsville, New York, which is kind of wedged in between Liberty and Ellenville, and how starved I was for professional contact. I wanted nothing more than to go to the Ansel Adams workshops. I mean, so what happened was something very lucky happened. I ended up, my dad, again, my dad's been very, very influential in terms of my photography, My dad ended up connecting with someone who needed a ride from his upstate New York base into New York. And the guy was a fine art photographer, not in the fine art image sense of the word, but actually someone who photographed works of art for people like Sotheby's. He worked for Lucian Goldschmidt and some of the Serge Zabarsky, some of the real heavy hitters in the art world. So for a 15-year-old like me to be his assistant, even if I'm just loading his Polaroid holders and handing them to him because they were shooting film back then, I was also working in his darkroom upstate. This to me was an entree into a world that I had no conception even existed or was even possible. What I think the point is that we will be bringing to these high school students in fairly remote corners of the US basically a big yes. Yes, you can do it. Yes, you can do your creative projects. You can live in a city. You can create the work. You can survive. You can take a career path that is not necessarily traditional, and still be true to yourself and still manifest your own creative vision of things. And I think that initial experience for me in high school, going to work for this particular photographer whose name was Nathan Rabin, was hugely, hugely influential in my life. And I feel very strongly that I want to bring that to these students as we travel. And that's one of the things that we will be doing. We'll be doing probably short 1-hour meetings with camera clubs and students taking photography classes, people in community centers, et cetera.
Yeah, so we're super excited about that aspect. And again, from my standpoint, it's also just be true to yourself, be authentic. It's funny, I had a conversation with a student of mine just basically, I think, 2 weeks ago. And we were saying how when I was in high school, when you were kind of a geek, you weren't included in anything. You were kind of always left out on the side. And these days, apparently, like if you're a geek, you're cool. Like there's something about you that is unique, and other kids kind of resonate with that. So, you know, if a child wants to express themselves by wearing crazy color clothing or crazy colored hair, go for it. You know, if you're expressing your voice and your style, trust that, follow that, and you know, if we can survive being photographers here in New York City, you can do it anywhere as long as you have that passion and that drive and you're really authentic and true to yourself and the vision that you want to create. We're all about supporting that creative spirit. So here's a little video so when we bought the map and we randomly chose, we videoed it. You have to pardon us, we're not videographers clearly, so it's not that good, but you'll get an idea of the excitement that we had when we chose our first location. And, so this is RA.
Those hands are mine. It's me.
And we
tried to do it so that I wouldn't know what the orientation of the map was, and we just plunked it right down.
Let's see what that is. Joshua Tree National Park.
Awesome. He chose well.
Yeah. Okay. Joshua Tree National Park.
Okay. West Coast.
So, yep. Just you can take a look. You can take a look. Just make sure you see where your finger is at.
Joshua Tree National Park near London Bridge.
London Bridge. That's.
So we're like right on the border between California and Arizona. Should we?
All right, so that was our first location. As you can see, we're super psyched about that. We have the other three videos up on our website, photographerssquared.com. But the other location, so I had the privilege of choosing the East Coast, and we'll be going to the Northern Pennsylvania, New York State border, specifically Steamtown. Which is steam trains?
It's known for having a steam restoration.
Yeah, so that should be exciting. Yeah. Then RA did the north.
Yeah.
And we're going to the mountains of Idaho.
Yeah.
Nez Perce National Park. Should be very interesting. And then I did, I chose in the south, we're going to Texas to the Gulf Coast, not far from Galveston, kind of in that area. So again, you get to choose the fifth location. You can be as specific as you want, or you can just kind of write down a state. So here's a backer and social media. You get to choose. So some information regarding the project. We are crowdfunding this, so we are on Kickstarter to help raise money to help make this happen. So far, as of this morning, maybe while we've done this presentation, we had some more backers. Let's cross fingers. So far we've received $4,837 from a total of 42 backers, and we're just extremely grateful for that. You want to talk about the fun fact?
Sure. The most interesting fun fact is we got a backer for $1,500 who was they were totally unconnected to us.
She doesn't know either of us.
Yeah, has never met either of us personally.
Yeah, she lives in Texas and saw us on Facebook through a link that was shared on Facebook.
Great.
So that was an amazing, wonderful experience right there. Our furthest location of backers, we've been supported by people in the Netherlands, Germany, France, and Israel. So it's exciting to see that we're getting backing from around the world. We currently have 28 days left and an outstanding balance of $10,763. So hopefully that number will dramatically decrease over the next 28 days. And that comes out to a total of $384 that we need to raise every day up until that point. So if you do feel inspired to help back us and make this project happen, we are on Kickstarter, and you just need to do a search on Photographer Squared, or you can type in our names, either of our names, yep, and you'll find it.
Or go to the project portal.
Or go to
which
our
is
project
the easiest
portal.
Way.
So we have our own website. It's photographers-squared.com. There you can also, if you'd like, join our mailing list. So we will be constantly posting photos and updates and videos and all that. Hopefully we'll have some photos from today's event that we can post up there. So you can go there and check that out. You can also see the other three remaining videos of the locations we chose.
And there are also links to Mindy's, your site?
My personal website, my class, my teaching, the Art of Intuitive Photography website, yeah. RA's websites.
And also Circus Photographica, if you're thinking of doing some late night revelry.
Sounds like fun. So do you get something if you back us? Yes, absolutely. So it's not like we just want your money and that's it. Depending on the level that you fund, we do give you rewards. So in fact, the woman who donated $1,500 gets a one-day workshop with either of us for two people, including a pair of prints, 16 by 16 inch prints, and the book, autographed book. So what we also are offering are private lessons, either 1 hour or 2 hour lessons, either with myself or RA. So if any of you are interested in learning how to photograph with a medium format camera, or if you want to learn how to develop film in your own kitchen, RA can do that for you. And what you can do to help. So if you want to share our link on Facebook, we won't say no. You can tweet us, we're on Twitter, share our link on LinkedIn. Tell your friends, spread the word. Hopefully you resonate with this as much as we do in wanting to really make a difference in the world of the teenagers, exploring their creative avenues, as well as, again, having a beautiful book created to showcase how we all have our own unique eye. So we'll have time now for Q&A if anybody has any questions. A big thank you to all of you again for attending. It's really very much appreciated. And here you see our links to our portal, to the Kickstarter, my personal site, RA's personal site, and the Art of Intuitive Photography. So thank you.
Thank you.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.